Remind me to never speak after Mr. Basile Upande. I was so engrossed in what he was saying, I seem to have forgotten how I wanted to start. But I will tell you this. I will start by telling you, oh, what a tangled web we weave when first we practice to deceive. And I make that statement to many of the members in Parliament and ministers of government today. My brothers and sisters of the former sugarcane industry, I welcome you once again, as I have done many occasions for the past 2 years. I welcome you to Rienzi Complex. But today I welcome you with a sense of sadness and reflection, no joy or happiness. I welcome you because today we are attempting to comprehend what went wrong. What has gone wrong? You see, we are wondering what happened after years of systematic and organized discrimination against us by the PNM. After years of abandonment and neglect by the PNM. After years of living under a regime that believed that there was nothing existing beyond the Caroni Bridge, and that Trinidad and Tobago was made up only of the East-West Corridor and Port of Spain. And we keep wondering, after years of being treated and facing the brutality of the PNM, which did nothing except attempt to destroy 250,000 people by the forced shutdown of the sugar industry, and the almost eradication of all the businesses that went with it. A PNM that attempted to destroy the economic, social, and cultural lifestyle of a people who never depended on political patronage or handouts to survive. A PNM that attempted to turn you into a state of dependency and depression. And we are still wondering, but more important than that, we are wondering what has happened to the joy and the hope we felt in 2010 when, with a 29-seat majority, a government that we voted into power swept away the PNM, and we thought at long last, the struggle was over, and the contempt and the disdain and the neglect and the abuse of our people, and more so the ex-Caroni workers, undecayed farmers, had come to an end. Today we are here and we are wondering still what went wrong and what has happened. Because I will tell you today, there seems to be elements within this government who are hell-bent on following the PNM policy and attempting to destroy the independence of our people, making them dependent on political patronage and handouts. Elements that are attempting to turn ex-Caroni workers into a permanent class of CPEP and ULP workers. Elements that are attempting to make you, like the PNM did to its own supporters, many of them along the East-West Corridor, to make you dependent not only on the state, but make you dependent on the patronage of ministers of government. I make these statements, brothers and sisters, because on March the 28th, over 3,000 of us took to the streets to demonstrate our disgust and our anger and our hurt and our pain at the way we were being treated by a government that we voted into office. And we called on the government in a meeting after that march to give us our just due. Today, it seems as though all that we have done is to no avail. Every single thing that we have done seems to have been gone in vain. And I want to be fair, as the chairman said, I want to be fair. The government has attempted to do a bit more than the PNM, but we have seen half-hearted attempts by government ministers as they attempt to deal with the issues that we have raised. Ministers who seem to think that you do not know what the DRC think judgment is, and ministers who seem to think that you do not know that the DRC think judgment said that any government, if it so wishes, has the power and the resources to expedite the process and ensure that every single ex-colony worker get what is due to them. They think we don't know that. We are still waiting on the $51 million owed to ex-colony workers who invested in the sweetener loan. And there's one junior minister who seems to keep missing the point totally, talking about the fact that you got back your principal. And what he's failing to understand is that you were fooled by the ADB and the UTC. And just as this government dealt with CLECO and dealt with the HCU, it has a responsibility and a duty to you as its supporters and the foundation upon which it stands to deal with that issue for you and give you back your $51 million that is owed to you and which should have been paid to you last November. And we are also questioning, in fact we did not get any response from the government when we called on them to take back the 9 sites that they stole from you, that were developed for you, and which they gave to the land for the landless, while many of you, over 2,000 of you, were brutally dislocated by them and sent to other areas. We called on the government on March 28th to give you back these sites. And on a tour recently, about a week ago, we have found huge signs in Orange Field, in Bokaro, in Factory Road. There's a site bar long in our Bang Village, signs saying land for the landless. Signs saying land for the landless on sites that were developed for you. And so we are again pleading with the government and demanding from this government that they give you back the lands that were stolen from you. And what is sad is that some of your own government ministers and members of parliament are saying that we are lying, even though they know what we are saying is the truth. And it seems as though this young lad, Jairam Simongal, is either clueless or he is turning a blind eye to the plight of the ex-colony workers. We are also waiting, after that March meeting, we are waiting on a response from the government concerning the documentation I asked for with regard to your reserve pension fund. And we are saying that before the elections, we gave them till May 24th. That has not been done. I want to ensure that before this general election, every one of you has a document in your hand that you could go to the Ministry of Finance or Central Bank and say, I want my $30,000 come 2016. All we have done is to ask for that documentation, and to date, it has not been received by the ex-colony workers. But I have a greater concern, because I have gained certain insights. People have reported to me certain allegations, and I use the word allegations because I'm not sure, but I'm hearing that our government, our cabinet, our members of parliament, our ministers of government that we voted for, that we pounded the pavement for, took a decision in cabinet to take your reserve fund money and give it back to you as though they were giving you the monies that you had paid for the residential lots. So what they are doing, or what it is alleged that they did, was they stole your reserve pension fund money, gave it back to you, telling you it's the money you paid for your residential lots, hoping to fool you and pretending that they are giving you back money, when in truth and in fact, they have taken your own money and given it back to you. But I don't want to believe this, because I do not think, and I'm sure you do not think, that our beloved Prime Minister will preside over a cabinet and take a decision like that. Because if that has been done, then it has to be one of the most vindictive and malicious acts ever perpetuated by a government against its own people and against its own supporters. So right now I'm saying I do not believe that. We are also waiting, and we called on them on March the 28th, we are also waiting for all sugar welfare loans to be written off. And I received a communication from Sugar Welfare about 2 days ago, which stated that it was being considered. So today, almost a month and a half after, we are still waiting to hear whether the sugar welfare loans would be written off. And we also said on March the 28th that every single expiring worker must receive a lease for your residential and 2 acre plots, because you are not the paper title owner of these plots unless you have a lease, a deed of lease with your names on it. License to occupy could easily be taken away and you could be dislocated at any time. And I want to tell Jairam Simangal that our figures as of today, my information as of today, there are over 5,000 ex-Tauri workers still to get leases for their residential lots. And there are over 4,000 ex-Tauri workers still to get leases for their agricultural plots. And that is in addition to many of you who have been allocated, dislocated, and still to be reallocated. We all have also been advised that Kaloni Limited seems to have moved away from its substantive position as the implementer of the visa package and has now become a real estate agency. We have been advised that they are no longer showing ex-Kaloni workers their lots or flats. And even if they show you, there are no specific boundaries, and then agents of Kaloni Limited are offering you a minimum price for your residential and 2 acre plots. These are the things that are happening. We have been advised that there are 680 leases already prepared and waiting for delivery to the ex-Kaloni workers, but you are not being called to collect it, because the government want to line you up on a stage as though they are giving you a gift and a handout, and take and use you for a photo opportunity to do as though they are giving you a favor. When in truth and in fact, what they are giving you is not a gift, but your legal entitlement under the law. And we are saying to the government today, do not use our people for photo opportunities. They have waited for 12 years. If the leases are prepared, give it to them. Give it to them, please. They are waiting too long. We have also had no response from the government with regard to the increase in the pension for ex-Kaloni workers. On March the 28th, we said, we want your pension to be increased by $850 to ensure that you could meet the ceiling of $4,500 that other citizens of this country enjoy. To date, ladies and gentlemen, there have been no response from this government. And that is why I tell you today, you have to remain united and you have to continue the struggle. Because if you don't, if you become lax and you are not ever vigilant, then the things you have earned by your sweat will be easily taken away from you. How many members of parliament, I have asked you before, have ever stood up, people who you voted for in the last 5 years, and articulated the issues of the ex-Kaloni workers or the cane farmers? I will tell you, none of them. The responses of our ministers of government and members of parliament leaves a lot to be desired, because you are the ones who voted for them and they are supposed to be fighting for you. You are not supposed to go elsewhere to get help. Minister Rujunathindal Singh, when questioned about these issues, like a stock record, all he can say is this is the best visa package ever negotiated in the country, and it's a work in progress. And what he's failing to tell you, that you are still waiting 12 years for the visa package. I mean, how ridiculous can you get? Ramona Randial is on record as saying, and I'm calling their names, I know this government loved to issue pre-action protocol letters So I'm calling their names. You never know, I may just receive one also. But they fail to understand that I too am a lawyer. Ramona Ramdiel. Ramona Ramdiel is saying that ex-colony workers cannot be found. She's on record as saying that they can't be found. I want to advise her today that I know that she's an individual who is unable to get as much as 50 people to follow her without the UNC. And even if there is the UNC, these people from CPEP and Europe have to be forced to follow her. And I'm advising her today, all you need to do is to come to one of our meetings and you will see the thousands of ex-colony workers who you are saying cannot be found. And this is a member of parliament who quite recently was shouting on the radio in a speech, 5,000 leases have been given out. And what she fails to understand is that there's a difference between the old lease and the new lease, because the old leases are no longer valid. And what she fails to understand is that there's a difference between an agricultural plot and a residential lot. And worse than that, this is a minister who did not know the difference between a cane farmer and an ex-colony worker. And I can tell you so openly because I am the one who explained to her the difference, and they want to represent us in parliament. And then we have Jairam Simangal.
Oh God.
This is the satellite minister. He believes that all the issues of the ex-colony workers can be solved by a satellite in space. All you need to do is to go on a computer, download a map, and you will see where your lands are located. And then, as if by magic, the computer will transport you to your land site. This space cadet do not even understand that you need proper infrastructural development, access roads, drainage, proper irrigation, ponds, crossings, and subsidies in order to access your lands. I don't even know if he understands the difference between an ex-colony worker, a cane farmer, a squatter, and a colony land tenant. Because about 2 months ago, in an article in the newspapers, he said, ex-colony workers will soon get their lands up in Toku. I leave it at that. This spaceman is also reported as saying that I should be dealing with the 900 ex-colony workers who need to do probates for their lands. And I want to tell him that the All Trinidad General Workers Trade Union, under its land management unit, headed by Mr. Stevie Ramkisoon, have already dealt with many of them. And in fact, we have helped over 1,500 ex-colony workers and cane farmers and tenants and squatters to get what is due to them. The question he should be asking is, what is happening to the offices that the government set up in Philly City and Debe and somewhere else to deal with the issues of the ex-colony workers? And when people go to those offices, they are being sent to my union to deal with the issues. Something has to be wrong with that. I'm asking the minister to investigate that. And then we have Minister Vasant, very nice chap, who with his eloquent and impeccable English keeps saying that I am misleading and misinforming the public. And in fact, the government's propaganda newspaper, The Voice, quite recently said that the only ex-colony workers who are protesting are those who applied for their visa package late. That is 1,200 of them, he says. Vasant, I want to tell you, when a man accepts a visa package, in this case a forced one, it becomes his entitlement under law. He must receive it automatically. The onus is on Colony Limited to ensure that this is done. It is illogical, Vasant, for a man to have to apply 10 different times for different parts of the same visa package. That is illogical. Give my people what is due to them. And in any event, Vasant, I've always said no amount of articles in the Voice newspaper, no amount of public relations gimmicks, no amount of GISL programs could convince a man that he got what is due to them, to him, if he did not get it. It's idiotic to think so. And Vasant, I want to tell you, the 4,000 ex-colony workers who marched with us, and the thousands that are here today, they cannot be misled, Vasant, because they know why they are here, and they know why they are marching. They are marching for their just due, and their just right. And then we have Devant. Anytime I make a statement, Devant say I am political. So I want to tell Devant today, yes, Devant, it's all about politics. Because any decision taken by any government and any policy implemented by any government that negatively affects the working class of this country, of whom you are a part, it is a political struggle and we have to engage in it. It's all politics, Devant, because very soon you and Tim will be fighting in Kaloni East. A safe UMC seat, even though, Devant, in 2007, you were a member of the COP and you fought against us. But that's all right. And yes, Devant, and politics again, I want to tell you that I'm looking forward to the runoff bill being passed in Parliament, because third parties will be at a disadvantage, maybe, but for the very first time in the history of this country, incumbent parties, including the United National Congress, could find themselves facing a runoff in some of their own hardcore constituencies, Devant. And this is where third parties, such as the National Solidarity Assembly, will act as a medium through which the discontent and the dissatisfaction of many of the people could be expressed. You see, there are many people who have voted for a particular party their whole lives because they did not have a choice of another one. And so, Devant, I am telling you that these third parties could very well be laying the foundation for the post-2015 election era. And I want you to remember also, Devant, because anytime I speak, you rush out and you start a talk about politics. I want you to know that if you do not genuinely care about the people, it is hard to fake it. And take my advice, Devant. Less texting on your phone when you are in official functions and more focus on the people and what is happening to them will give you a greater understanding of the plight of our people. That is if you have the capability to understand what they are facing. You see, brothers and sisters, we were mistaken. We have been betrayed by individuals using the United National Congress as a medium through which they could further their own agendas and seek their own interests. And when I told the government over and over again to take care of our people, take care of our supporters, take care of the people who would have pounded the pavement for you, they laugh at me. And they turn a blind eye to what I'm saying. When I tell them, help the people who have put you in power, they behave as though I am attacking them personally. But I'm not surprised, you see. I'm not surprised. But what they don't understand is that times are changing. And what they expect to happen when elections come, they may very well have a surprise. Because there are many people who are no longer content to go into a ballot box and just vote because you look like me. I can't take that to medical association, I can't take it to the grocery. So you have to do what you have to do for our people. Otherwise you may very well be surprised. And I will tell you this today, if there is a God in the sky, or if there is a God that exists, I tremble. For those whom we would have placed into power to take care of us. Because they have abandoned. They have abandoned us. And they have abandoned the jobs that we placed them there to do for us. But my brothers and sisters, I don't condemn the UNC, you know. I can't. I was a teenager. And while others were fighting in safe seats like Couva North and Couva South, and Kaluni East and Nakuriman Sipawea. After we stood in the mud and the rain and the sun in our West Savannah and we formed the UMC, I found myself as a teenager campaigning the length and breadth of the East West Corridor. I campaigned in places like Maloney and La Pocketa, the Congo, Sherwood Park, Aruka North, Aruka South. These are the places as a teenager that I campaigned for the UNC. And we are the ones who put the UNC into power. We are the ones who made them acceptable to the East West Corridor. We are the ones, and Mr. Pandey will tell you, the first time you went into Levant Hill to do a meeting, you had men like Nicholas Fleming in a jeep behind with machine gun to ensure that he was safe. We are the ones who laid the foundation for the UNC on the East West Corridor. So I have earned the right to speak about the UNC and tell the UNC to take care of your supporters now. I have earned that right more than many of those people who now call themselves UNC. Because many of them think that the UNC began in 2010. And they do not understand the struggles and the battles that we fought to build the UNC. And I am saying to you today, and I will tell them whether they like it or not, that someone has to be brave enough and courageous enough to stand up and tell them the time has come to take care of your people. You must give us what is rightfully ours. You became farmers, the ex-colony workers sitting in the audience today, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because you have had to beg the UNC for what is due to you. And that is why, my brothers and sisters, I have no apologies for forming the National Solidarity Assembly, forming a house that is separate from the UNC. Because like any family, when you have disagreements, you may very well move out and build a new house. And I'm not saying that there can't be amending offenses. All I'm saying is in order for us to come back to the family house, you have to take care of your people. You cannot treat one child better than the other one. We are all equal. We all fought for the UNC. And the time has come to be the creatures of equals. And I will tell you, I do not think there's any prime minister or leader who will deliberately undermine her people or his people, who will deliberately work to the detriment of their people. I don't think there's any leader who will do that. But what I will tell you is that the Prime Minister has certainly been misled and misinformed, and the Prime Minister must take certain decisions. She has to take stock and remove the millstones that surround, that weigh down the neck. Take it out and throw it away. And then, just maybe then, when we feel that the house has been cleaned from the rats that now occupy it, we could then come back home. Madam Prime Minister, you have a job to do. You have to clean house. And I'm telling you today, as long as you have to beg and plead and demonstrate for what is yours, for your legal entitlement, that struggle is not over. And we cannot go back home. And I will tell you the same thing I told you in April 2014. We must no longer allow those in authority to believe they have a divine right to our support. You must understand that members of parliament are public servants. Their job is to serve you, not you serving them. And when you have members of parliament who sit there and can't string two sentences together, or write a proper essay, or don't understand reasoning or logic or rationale, and don't have an independent thought in their heads, then you know we have really reached the pits. When you have members of parliament who represent cane farmers and sugar workers, and for 5 years they stay quiet, you know we have really reached the bottom. And that is why I will tell you today, as Pandey said, Mr. Pandey said, the time has come to vote for candidates, people who will represent your interests. Because if you vote for a party and the person who is in your constituency don't care about you, you're still in the same position you were before the elections.